Alright, so today's video is all about braising. So like many things in life, braising can be as simple or complicated as you want to make it. In today's video, I am going to share with you my distilled down formula for braising. In other words, this is braising 101. If you'd like to get more technical or want to try something a little more advanced, I'll post a few links below so you can check those out. To understand how to braise, we first need to define it. To do so, I'll reach for my deluxe food lover's companion. Alright, let's see, braise. This thing is a tome. Look how thick that is. The pages are even gold. Flex. Ah, here we are. Page 69. Can't make it up. Braise. A cooking method by which food is first browned in fat, then cooked tightly covered in a small amount of liquid at low heats for a lengthy period of time. In other words, braising allows us to eat tough braising cuts of meat, which would otherwise be too tough or, you know, hard to eat. It would be very unpleasant and would probably provoke your TMJ. Yes, you can definitely also braise other foodstuffs like vegetables and other things too. However, today's video is going to be focused on le meat. Throwing a hunk of meat in a braise is also a fantastic way to cook for a crowd, to cook in bulk for the week. And though the process is sort of a long one, it's actually very hands-off. First, let's talk about what makes up a braise.
Jesus.
Okay, first things first, the meat. In a braise, we use tough cuts of meat, which are also sometimes referred to as braising cuts. These cuts come from parts of the animal that were heavily worked out throughout the animal's life. Think like shanks, brisket, thighs, etc. Most of these tough cuts are packed full of connective tissue and tough collagen that will break down into soft, succulent gelatin over the long braising process. One more thing to note is that the smaller the animal, the less sturdy the collagen and the less time it takes to break down the protein. For example, a chicken thigh or a duck leg might take an hour to braise, where like a leg of lamb or a brisket could take like 4 to 6 hours. And personally, I would never braise tender cuts like chicken breast or filet mignon. They would just dry out. On to the liquid. Now, this might seem super obvious, but we need to make sure that the liquid in our braise is super flavorful. If the braising liquid is flavorful, there's a pretty solid chance that the finished product's going to be flavorful too. I like to think of the liquid as a base that we add to. So like, for example, a base might be a stock, a puree, or a juice of sorts, and the additions might be like aromatics, acid, or other seasonings. Just remember that the braising liquid should be somewhat acidic, as acid helps denature muscle proteins. For example, like, you know, a tomato paste, puree, honey, citrus, vinegar, the list goes on. There's a lot of acid out there. Just don't go buying any off the street. Last but not least, the aromatics. Aromatics can be thought of as any food item that enhances the flavor or aroma of a dish. So think herbs, spices, vegetables, I don't know, even different liquids. But in the case of a braise, I think liquids are important enough to have their own category, so we are going to X that off. The aromatics that you choose to cook with and the flavor of the braising liquid will define the flavor structure of your finished braised dish.
Excellent. Now that we know what's inside of a braise, let's talk about how we braise and the best practices to do so.
I will do my best to keep this to the point, and then we'll dive right into the cooking. First, we need to deal with the meat. You're going to want to clean the meat by trimming off any extra fat or silver skin that you might not want in your braise. A little fat is good, but sometimes the cut might be a little too fatty, but that's all personal preference. Then we need to season the meat with salt. You can either brine the meat overnight in a liquid solution, season the meat a day or a few hours ahead of time, or simply just season up right before cooking. Brining or seasoning the meat ahead of time allows it to stay juicier and fully season the meat from the inside out. However, if you don't have the time to do this, don't let it stop you from cooking. I'll post a super simple equation for how you can brine your own meat below. This is also your chance to portion out the meat how you see fit. Sometimes a pork shoulder is just too dang large to fit in a Dutch oven, so don't be afraid to slice it in half. Moving on to the sear. This part is pretty self-explanatory, but we need to first sear the meat and the vegetables to develop that flavor before we put it in the wet environment, which would disallow browning. Do not rush the step. Brown food is flavorful food, so make sure your food has color. Before the sear, some people dust their meat in flour, which helps to thicken the braising liquid. Though, in my opinion, this step is somewhat redundant because we're going to just reduce things down at the end anyway to create like a viscous sauce, so unnecessary, but dust away if you do so desire. Alright, the cook. This is where the magic happens. We need to bring our braise up to a low temperature from a cold oven to keep it in a specific temperature range that will allow for what's called accelerated aging. This basically means that our meat will spend less time at temperatures that might dry it out. And yes, braised meat can still turn out dry if you don't pay attention. To dweeb out more about this topic, check the references below. Lastly, we have the cool. After the braising process, we need to let the meat cool down in its juices to at least 130 degrees Fahrenheit, 54 Celsius, so that it can reabsorb flavorful juices lost during the cooking process. If you have the self-control, strain the braise and store the meat in its juices overnight in the fridge for maximum flavor. And I didn't write it down, but reduction of the cooking liquid is included in this last step, which we will go over in the video to come.
All right, so pretty straightforward. I'm gonna show you how to do it today. I'm going to braise a pork shoulder. Why? Because pork shoulder is a burly, inexpensive, super flavorful cut of meat. So let's get into it.
Step one, season up. I brine my meat in a 1% equilibrium salt brine, which is a fancy way of saying that I soak the protein in salty water to make it juicier. Skip this step and salt on the spot if you'd like, but I'll show you how to do this below if you're interested. Cut up your aromatic vegetables of choice into roughly similar sized pieces. This will help them brown near the same rate. We won't end up eating these vegetables, so no need to get fancy with the knife work. Now onto the flavorful liquid. Here I'm creating a mixture of tomato paste, vinegar, honey, and wine. All these ingredients are acidic, which will help break down our tough cut of meat. Later, I'll add this to our braise along with a liquid base of chicken stock. Now we need to sear off and brown our protein and aromatic veg. If you dwell in a small apartment with hypersensitive, hyper-annoying smoke detectors, like I do, now is a good time to pop open a window or two. Add a little high heat oil to the pan, I'm using grapeseed. And brown away. If your place still smokes out with a window open, try opening another one to create a draft that, in theory, should channel all the smoke outside. Really take your time to sear and make sure that your food takes on some color. Now is the only time you'll get to add the flavors that come with the browning process. Sear all sides of the meat, including any ends. Once browned to your liking, transfer the meat to a tray and add the veg. Don't forget to season. The water within the vegetables will cook out and make its way into the pan, in turn deglazing the burnt bits off the bottom of the pan. And we want this to happen. Those burnt bits crusted onto the bottom of the pan are flavorful as heck. And I maybe could have even taken these a little further, but now it's in Zeus's hands. Transfer the caramelized veg to the tray with the seared meat and add in other aromatics, such as any herbs, spices, or other seasonings. Here I'm adding garlic, fresh thyme, dried bay, and fresh parsley. Now pour over the flavorful liquid. I'll first pour in my chicken stock. You can use store-bought, but homemade is always best if you have it laying around. Then follow up with the super thick acidic mixture right over the top. If you're braising in a vessel with no lid, use tin foil to seal it off. Just remember that most food-grade foils react to acidic compounds, especially over the course of a long cooking period. To keep anything gnarly from dissolving into your food, line the foil with parchment paper so that only the paper is coming into contact with the food. Problem solved. Also, if you have not noticed, I made two separate braises. In respect to keeping this video simplified, we're only going to be focusing on one, which is the pork shoulder. Now we're ready to cook. We need to place the braise in a cold oven, then turn it onto a super low temperature to help the meat stay in a sweet spot and tenderize. Start on 200 degrees Fahrenheit, then after 2 hours, bump the heat up to 250 degrees Fahrenheit for another hour. After 3 hours, check for doneness every 30 minutes to avoid overcooking. And braising liquid is hot, so don't spill. Unleash your now finished braise and admire all the beauty that birthed from your patience. But don't eat it yet. Let it cool to 130 degrees Fahrenheit, or better yet, wait a day to eat it. Okay, so now it's the next day and you are ready to munch. You could strain things the night prior to make your life easier, but I got busy, so I'm going to do it now. Heat up your braise, then transfer the meat to a separate dish and strain out the braising liquid and vegetables. Make sure to squeeze out any remaining precious juice from those vegetables. You can use the back of a spoon to do this. From here, you can either eat the meat and use the braising liquid as is, or you can reduce the liquid to your desired consistency by boiling it until thick. And I mean, come on. Tell me you don't want to floss your teeth with that glorious shreddy pork. I mean that, or like, I don't know, make tacos or something. After cooling, I like to keep the braising liquid and meat in separate containers for versatility, but you can also just store the meat in its juices and it'll be bomb.net. Bomb.com's totally played out. I'm going to plate up with some white rice, a little cabbage slaw, and some soy pickles. And this is really just one idea. With a chunk of succulent braised meat in your fridge, the opportunities to throw together a killer flavor-packed meal in minutes are endless. And it's time to go in.
Right. Alright, so I hope I did a good job simplifying that. And to my nerds out there who are interested in learning more about the technical side of braising, some of the more chefy stuff, take a little bit of a deeper dive, I'll link some resources below that I really love and that I've learned a bunch from. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and I will see all of y'all next week. Toodaloo.